Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Good to be here this morning. It really is. No matter how nervous I am, it is so good to be here amongst the Lord's people on the Lord's Day to not only enjoy the Word of God, but to celebrate communion, which we're going to do right after this meeting. Now, this morning, we're going to begin in Jeremiah chapter 29, and so that's where we're going to begin reading. If you don't have a Bible or you don't know where that is, in a pew Bible, probably next to you or close to you, it's on page 656. 656. So, we begin then in Jeremiah chapter 29 and verse 1. These are the words of the letter that Jeremiah the prophet sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders of the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the people whom Nebuchadnezzar had taken into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This was after King Jeconiah and the queen mother, the eunuchs, the officials of Judah and Jerusalem, the craftsmen, and the metal workers had departed from Jerusalem. This letter was sent by the hand of Elisha, the son of Shaphan, and Gemariah, the son of Hilkiah, from Zedekiah, the king of Judah, sent to Babylon, to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. It said, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles who I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat their produce. Take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage, that you may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, and in its welfare you will find your welfare. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are among you deceive you, and do not listen to the dreams that they dream, for it is a lie that they are prophesying to you in my name. I didn't send them, declares the Lord. For thus says the Lord, when 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans of welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." This ends the reading of God's holy word. Let's open in a word of prayer. Our Father, we pray that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear and a heart to understand today your word of God, that you would grant the not only the ability to speak your word, but the ability to take it in, to take it into our hearts and have it spring up into everlasting life, Father. Help us now, we pray, as we come to you in that blessed and wonderful name, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Be seated. I think this is still on, isn't it? Is this on? I'm going to set this right over here. Well, today we are going to, this is going to be our sort of our launching pad, sort of the backdrop of what we're looking at today. We're actually going to spend most of our time in the book of Daniel. Daniel and Jeremiah 29 sort of go together like this. Daniel will explain how it is that God is going to provide for his people in the book or in the nation of Babylon. And Jeremiah is written to those people in Babylon telling them, look, build houses, settle down, you're going to be there for a while, pray for the peace of Babylon. Because in the peace of Babylon, you will have peace. And you know, you can imagine, this is in about 600 BC, so this would have been about, I don't know, my math is terrible. I'm hardly a preacher, and I'm not at all a mathematician. But it's probably 2700 years ago from now. But if you think about it, these Daniel and his brethren And some of them were carpenters, some of them were goldsmiths, some of them were silversmiths, some of them were priests, and so on and so forth, sort of an odd mixture of people, a mixed multitude. They were taken captive by Nebuchadnezzar's army, and they were deported to Babylon. Now, Nebuchadnezzar had not yet leveled the city of Jerusalem. That would happen in 586. That's going to happen about 20 years from the date of this letter. But already he has deported thousands and thousands of people from Jerusalem to Babylon. Now, he isn't just going willy-nilly through the land, taking anybody and everybody. He's trying to be discriminate in who he takes. He's taking the best of the best. He takes some to work at his court, to learn all of the wisdom of Babylon. They're going to be counselors. They're going to be administrators. They're going to be government officials and so on and so forth. He's taking a lot of artisans. But in essence, he isn't just gathering people up willy-nilly on the street. He is sort of, in a sense, being selective in who he takes, who he basically kidnaps and deports to Babylon. And so you can imagine how it would be. There you are, you're eating lunch with your family around the table, and two Babylonian soldiers show up the door, and they say, "You, not you, and then you, come with me." And you know that you're never going to see mom and dad and brother and sister, and whatever relationships you've had in the past are now going to be completely different, because you're going into captivity, and in all likelihood, you will never see Jerusalem again. You'll never see your loved ones. You'll never see your parents. You'll never go to work. You're not going to work in the morning. You're going somewhere else. And so you can imagine how difficult it must have been and to arrive in Babylon. But this letter that God sends by the hand of Jeremiah is a letter of encouragement. He says, look, you're there for a purpose. Notice in the fourth verse, he says, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile. Sent in exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. The cause of their exile, if you think about it, it was God who exiled them. Not the king of Babylon. God, the king of Babylon wasn't choosing you, not you, you, not you, and then you four guys. Our God knows what he's doing at all times, and he does as he pleases in the army of heaven. And so God had purposely deported thousands, tens of thousands of people out of Jerusalem prior to what? Prior to his judgment that was coming. When his judgment comes and he unleashes the forces of Babylon on Jerusalem and Judea, the Bible says he's going to wipe Jerusalem clean like a plate. You know, everybody's had been to turkey dinner and everything, and you know, you get done and mom says, now clean off your plate in the garbage can before, and then rinse it off and put it in. And so you go over the garbage can, you take a knife and you go whoosh. And then you go and you rinse the plate off and maybe you put it in the dishwasher. That is a descriptive of what the Lord says he's going to eventually do in Jerusalem. And that will take place in 586 B.C. So you can imagine if you were one of the ones that were deported and you could see this coming, or you were still alive at the time that Jerusalem was leveled, you would have been tremendously saddened and for your home and for the city and for the temple and for the service of God there. But you would have been thankful that God had taken you out of the city. Now, that's pretty selfish thinking, but how many of us aren't that way? You would have been thankful that God had removed you from the city prior to the slaughter that took place. And you know, isn't it like the Lord? You know, in a time when you look at this instance and you think, oh, this is the worst thing that could ever happen. How can you do this to me, God? And yet God has a plan. And the plan is, I'm going to move you out of harm's way. Yeah. Well, what do you mean? I'm going into captivity. Yeah, I've got this worked out. Just relax. I've got this worked out. We not only have a God who knows the end from the beginning, but we have a God who ordains the end from the beginning. You know, I think I wrote it down here in my note, but the seventh question in the Westminster Shorter Catechism, what are the decrees of God? The question is. And the answer is that the decrees of God are his eternal purpose according to the counsel of his own will, whereby for his own glory he has foreordained whatsoever comes to pass. Now, he didn't foreordain the sins of Israel. God doesn't, he's not the author of sin. But the sin of Israel was folded into the overall purposes of God. And when they sinned, he had an answer. And it wasn't an answer that he came up when they sinned, like, let's see, that's on page 38. When they sin, we do. No, God has an answer from eternity for all things. And so those who went into captivity were those whom God had chosen from eternity to go into captivity to escape the judgment that was coming. Now, these things are hard to understand, but then our God is hard to understand, isn't he? God is infinite, eternal, and unchangeable. And so in that aspect, seeing how none of us are infinite, none of us are eternal, and none of us are unchangeable, then how is it that we can understand God in a mature way? Well, we're called to believe and to trust him. And so they were called to believe and to trust him and to believe the promise. He says, settle down, build houses, plant gardens, eat the produce, take wives if you're not married, and take husbands and have children, and then build a family. And in 70 years, I'm going to bring you back to the land. Once he had purged the land, he would bring them back. You know, in the seventh verse of this same passage in Jeremiah 29, he says, and seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. Now, their welfare was not dependent upon how hard they prayed or how often they prayed or how long their prayers were or how many these and thous and whithersoever's were contained in the prayer. None of those things were contingent upon what God was going to do. When God tells us and instructs us to pray, he's inviting us to be laborers together with him. God has a work. I want you to be a laborer together with me. Pray for the welfare of this city, because in the welfare of the city, in the peace of this city, you are going to experience peace. They would experience peace at the God who says, I am your peace. That's how they would experience peace. And when they prayed in alliance with the Lord over his purposes, then they became fellow laborers together with God. You know, it's sort of like that verse in Philippians where he says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Boy, if you stop right there, you have a works-based gospel, don't you? Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But the answer is, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. And so in like manner, pray for the city. Pray for the peace of this city, because I'm going to create peace. And in the peace of this city, you will have peace. And so God takes his people out of the way of judgment. Judgment, by the way, which was coming at his hand and by his design. He takes them out of the way of judgment, and he hides them in plain sight in an enemy's land. Our God is an awesome God. To be hidden in plain sight in an enemy's land and to be protected there until the storm is over is almost, I mean, who would have thought of that? I mean, I'll take you to Babylon. Well, Babylon's the enemy. Yeah, I know, but I'm going to hide you down there. I'll take you there while they're here. So at any rate, we need to move on. And I want to go to the book of Daniel, because it's in the book of Daniel that some of the ways, some of the means that God uses to deliver his people while they're in captivity. Now, as we think about deliverance, we might think, well, a raise would be handy. A little bit better health would be good. A car that didn't break down all the time would really be fine. Kids that didn't cry all night would be helpful. These are things that, God, you could do to help me in my life. But God's going to approach this in a way that nobody could ever imagine, how he will pour out grace on his people and establish them as a people who obviously have the favor of God. Imagine he takes them into an enemy's land, and now God's going to display his favor on them and almost make them untouchable in the eyes of the Babylonians. So the big idea today then is in our fighter verse, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans of welfare and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." And if you're a King James Version guy, which I am, which I was, now I'm a new King James, so I'm slowly moving in the right direction, as some would say. But he knows, "I know the plans, I know the thoughts that I have for you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." God has an expected end. He has a plan for our life. And if we're in Babylon and we can't understand why we're here and what's going on and it just seems so hard, we can look at this story, this true narrative, this true history of the people of God and see that no matter how dark it is, God is God and nobody else is. And he's able to pierce the darkness and to deliver us in times of tremendous pressure and problems. So the big idea then is found in Daniel chapter 4, verses 34b through 35. And we're going to actually close with this verse at the end. So if you want to turn there, I don't have it written down what exactly it is, but I'll read it to you. Daniel 4, 34b and 35, otherwise halfway through the 34th verse. This is Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, speaking. After what I think is his conversion, he says, speaking of God, he says, "For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, and he does according to his will among the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. And none can stay his hand or say to him, 'What have you done? What are you doing? What is this? Why am I here?'" We can't really say that, can we? I mean, we might ask those questions. But in reality, God holds the future in his hands. I love that verse, "Be still, my soul." He who guides the future, or he who has guided the past, will and does guide the future. And that's who we need to look to. So, if you will, turn to Daniel chapter 2. Now, Daniel chapter 2, where I know that almost everybody in this room has been through the book of Daniel and you've read the narratives and they're wonderful. Chapter 1 covers how Daniel and his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, become counselors. They're trained up in all of the education that Babylon had to offer, and they were being prepared for positions of administrators and counselors, people who were in positions of wisdom. And so they were being trained for that particular purpose in the court of Babylon. Now, what happens, we're going to talk about the instrumental means, the means by which God begins to pour out his favor on his people. And it's such a strange way that he does it. And of course, often the way God does things seems so out of sort to us. We look at him and go, "Wow, that's really weird. He did it that way. I would have never thought of it." Yeah, really. Yeah, you wouldn't have ever thought of that. And not only wouldn't you have ever thought of it, but none of us would have ever been able to do anything that God does. And so we know the story. What God does is he gives the king of Babylon a series of dreams. And he can't quite get a hold of him. You ever have a dream that just drives you nuts? And you got a piece of it, or maybe you've got half of it, and it's you wake up in a cold sweat and you have difficulty getting back to sleep. And now look, you know it's just a dream, but you know, there's always that chance that this might be a heads up, you know? Find your helmet, get your combat boots on, get your rifle, because this could be a heads up. You never know. And so he has this dream, and he is really exercised by the dream, and he can't sleep. In fact, he's had more than one dream because the text says he had dreams, and he can't really remember it, but he knows one thing. He's been in a cold sweat, and he wants an answer. You want to, when a despot wants an answer, he's going to get an answer one way or the other. So he calls the astrologers, and he calls the wise men of Babylon and all those people, and he calls a man, and he says, I've got a job for you. And they say, well, what? Live forever, O king. Don't you love that, how they do that? Live, you know, they're just sucking up to the king like crazy because, you know. And so he says, I've had a dream. I need just two things from you fellas. I need to know what the dream is, and I need to know what the interpretation is. And they go, Yeah, we could give you the interpretation. Just tell us the dream, and we'll give you the interpretation. He goes, no, you will tell me the dream and give me the interpretation, or I will kill you all, every one of you. And he says, well, just tell us the dream. He said, look, I know what you're doing. You're trying to buy time. That's what you're trying to do. You're just trying to buy time, and I know the game, but that's not going to be played today. You're going to tell me the dream, and you're going to give me the interpretation, or you will die, your families will die, your houses will be burned to the ground. Tell me the dream. And so he gave them time, and finally he sent out the guard and said, kill them all. And so when Daniel heard about this, he was sort of in the periphery of what was happening. He was being trained up to be a king's counselor. But when he heard about all this uproar and what was happening, and he asked the captain of the guard, what's going on? What's going on? He said, well, the king's had a dream. He wants to know the dream. Nobody's telling him the dream. I've been sent out to kill everybody. He said, just give me some time here. And Daniel goes home, and he talks to his three friends, and they pray to the Lord, and the Lord gives Daniel not only the dream, but the interpretation of the dream. And so we pick up in Daniel chapter 2. Now, right at the time that the edict goes out to kill all the wise men in Babylon, Daniel intervenes. This is on page 738 in the Pew Bible. Daniel intervenes. He tells the captains of the guard, he said, look, I know the dream, let me in, I'll go talk to the king. So we have it in verse 25, then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king in haste and said thus to him, I have found among the exiles. You know, he's in haste, he's probably, he doesn't want to see this happen. I don't know if he had any friends who were counselors of the king, but he's obviously in a hurry here. And he says, I have found among the exiles from Judah a man who will make known to the king the interpretation. And the king declared to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar. He'd been given a Babylonian name. Are you able to make known to me the dream that I have seen and its interpretation? Daniel answered and said to the king, no. How do you like that? He just says, no, wise man. But I mean, in essence, he said, no, I can't do that. And the way he explains it, this, he says, no wise man, enchanters, magicians, or astrologers can show to the king the mystery that the king has asked. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, and he has made known to the king, to King Nebuchadnezzar, what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head as you lay in bed are these. Now he cuts right to the point. He gets right to it. He says, to you, O king, as you lay in bed, came thoughts of what would be after this. And he who reveals mysteries made known to you what is to be. But as for me, this mystery has been revealed to me not because of any wisdom that I have, nor than all the living. No, excuse me. Not because of any wisdom that I have more than all the living, but in order that the interpretation may be made known to the king and that you may know the thoughts of your mind. You saw, O king, and behold, a great image. The image was mighty and of exceeding brightness stood before you, and its appearance was frightening. Now he'd seen this big statue. He'd seen this huge image. It had a gold head and I think it had a bronze arms and chest, and the middle section of the thighs were silver, and the feet were iron and mud or clay. And he'd seen this thing, and it terrified him. And then he's seen this rock that wasn't cut out by anything, but it says it was cut out without hands, and it comes flying down, and it hits the bottom of this this great big image, and when it crashes into it, it grinds the legs and the feet into powder, and the whole thing comes cascading down, and it's all ground into powder and blows away. And you know, it's used in the scripture. He uses this, he says it was like the chaff in the summer. You know what they did with the wheat? When they brought the wheat in, they would bring it into the threshing floor, which was usually this big, smooth stone in the ground, and they would throw it all on. They'd get rid of as much of the straw as they could, but they'd throw it on the threshing floor, and the animals would walk over it, and wheels would be rolled across it until they had sort of broken it up a little bit, and then people would come in with winnowing forks, and you pitch in like this, and you throw it up in the air, and the wind would blow and blow the chaff away, and the wheat would fall to the ground. Well, this is a picture of God taking this image and grinding it into nothing and blowing away everything that's bad. So he tells him what his dream is, and then he gives him the interpretation, and the only part of this that I'm really interested in the interpretation is this, is he tells him exactly what's going to happen. Well, let me just see. I had it in my notes. Here it is. Verse 36, this was the dream. Now we tell the king its interpretation. You, O king, the king of kings, to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power, and the might, and the glory, into whose hand he has given wherever they dwell, the children of men, the beasts of the field, the birds of the heaven, making you rule over them all, you are the head of gold. And you know what it's like. When somebody's explaining something to you, and you are part of the message, and they say, and you're really a good guy. And then they keep talking. You sort of turn off right there, you know. Let me think about that good guy part. I really like that part. I think he got to the head of gold part. You are the head of gold. And he goes, wow. And he sort of missed the rest of what the interpretation was. He sort of tuned out because, you know, this head of gold thing, that's a pretty interesting thing, you know. That's pretty. I always thought, you know, I was sort of special. But, you know, you mentioning it now sort of makes that a real deal in my mind. And the reality is this image, of course, and most of us know this because we've heard preaching on this, but this is a delineation of the empires, beginning with the Babylonian Empire, and then I think the next empire was what, the Medes and the Persians, and the next one was Alexander the Great, and the next one was Rome, okay. So, and that's not what we're looking at today anyway, but this is a real interesting passage if you're into historical empires. And so one of the things that Nebuchadnezzar realizes right away is that being the head of gold, the first empire, whatever this stone is that's going to crush everything isn't going to come in his day. Why worry? You know, he gets the Hezekiah, he has a Hezekiah moment. You know what a Hezekiah moment is. Hezekiah moment is when the prophet comes to you and said, you know those guys that you sold, that you showed all of the gold of the land and all of the treasuries and all of the vessels in the house of God and all your shields of gold and all your spears, and you talked about all of your mighty might and all of your armies. You know those guys? Oh, yeah, I know those guys, yeah. Well, those guys are going to be coming your way someday with a mighty army, and they're going to take your children captive, and they will serve the king of Babylon. You have just showed the enemy all of his goods. You know, Hezekiah said, and I have said this myself, so I sympathize with him. He said, well, isn't it a good thing if there's peace in my day? I mean, have you ever said anything like that? That's coming down the road. Let those people, I mean, if they'd straighten up and fly right, they could handle that, but at least there's going to be peace in my day. And that's sort of Nebuchadnezzar's point here. That's coming later. Right now, I'm the head of gold. It's me. It's all about me. And he really misses the gospel here because the gospel's contained in the stone. The stone is the thing that crushes all of these empires and crushes all of the might of man and all of the designs of man and fills the whole earth with a kingdom that shall never be moved. That's the gospel in this passage. He misses the gospel. It's like a person who hears, "For God so loved the world," and then they quit listening. Because I'm part of the world, God must love me. And they never go on where it says, "He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. But he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God shall abide." They don't hear that. They just hear the love part, you know. And look, God is loving, but God is also just and righteous. And so Nebuchadnezzar got what he wanted out of the message, and I am telling you, he was a happy man that day because he realized when Daniel told him what was going on, Daniel had the key to his problem. Daniel had the true vision of what the dream actually was, and he'd given him this wonderful interpretation. I mean, I'm the head of gold. I mean, that's really, I really like this Daniel guy. But think about this. Remember when God said, "In the peace of this city, you will have peace"? God just shined favor on his people. How did he do it? He worked from the top down. He went to the king. He gives the king a dream. He causes the only one to be able to interpret the dream to be Daniel. And that shines God's favor on all of the captives. They now become a pretty special people. You think about it. But then along comes Satan. Of course, it always works this way, doesn't it? And he probably whispers into old Nebuchadnezzar's ear, "You know what you ought to do? I got a really great idea. This is a wonderful dream. We need to memorialize this thing. I mean, this is an important message from God, and we need a memorial. Let's build an image. We'll build an image just like the image you saw in the dream. Remember, king, you're the head of gold. And we got to memorialize this wonderful thing." And so he does. He builds this image of gold out in the plain, and he makes an edict to all of the outer territories. He wants everybody who is in a position of power, all the government officials, he wants them to come in. And what we're going to do is we're going to have the music play, and then everybody's going to bow before this great image, because, by the way, this image came about because of a dream that God gave me. Certainly God will accept this worship. And, of course, we know the story. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego says, "No, we're not doing that. We can't do that. We're not doing that." And the king said, "You'll do it or you'll die." And they said, "Well, that could be true. God will either deliver us from the fiery furnace that you intend to throw us into, but he will for certain deliver us from you." You know, this is the message to the martyr, isn't it? The martyr may not escape the fire of the fiery furnace, but he will escape the hand of the devil. Because God is God, and he will deliver. And so, Nebuchadnezzar, you know, he's going to have his way because he is certain that he's doing the right thing. He throws these three guys in the fiery furnace, and we know the end of the story. They didn't burn. Instead, they survived. And even as Nebuchadnezzar got down on his hands and knees and he looked in the furnace, of course, he had to be way away from it because, remember, they heated it up to 7 times capacity. And the guys who threw the three Hebrew children into the fiery furnace, they died just doing it. You can imagine, they got their fire suits on, they got their helmet on, they got this other stuff. I mean, they're probably well-dressed. And they get near the furnace and to throw them in, and they died from the blast coming out. Well, Nebuchadnezzar, he looks in there like this, and I see 4 guys in there. I thought, he has to ask somebody, "Didn't we throw 3 guys in?" He said, "Yeah, we threw 3 guys. Well, and one of them looks like the son of the gods," he says. See, Nebuchadnezzar's not converted. He's a raw pagan king. And he doesn't get what. And so when these guys get out, He makes this statement. Let's look at it here. See, I preached right ahead. I preached two pages without looking at him. That ought to be worth something right there. He says, you know, Nebuchadnezzar is given to hyperbole. This isn't really hyperbole what he's going to say here, but he is really moved by this event. And notice in the third chapter, verse 28, he says, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego." He just fished them out of the furnace. Their clothes don't even smell burnt. They're not a hair singed on them, and they're as healthy as the day they were thrown, or the moment they were thrown in. He said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him and set aside the king's command and yielded up their bodies rather than serve and worship any god except for their own. Therefore, I make a decree." This is what we really need, see. After this mighty thing that God does, we need a king making a decree. As if it wasn't enough that God did what he did, we need this pagan king to throw in with God, you know, to really make the word of God forceful. I mean, this is sort of kind of a knucklehead thing to do. But he does. He makes this decree, but this really serves for the people. Notice, "Therefore I make a decree, any people, nation, or language that speaks anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be torn limb from limb and their houses laid ruin, for there is no other God who is able to rescue in this way." Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon, and all of the captives said, "Amen. Hallelujah." Is that right? Because what happens when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are exalted? What happens when Daniel answers the king and gives him not only the dream but the interpretation? Well, the captives whom God had exiled into Babylon and promised to protect them there and give them peace, the light, the glow of the glory of God shines on them. Isn't that amazing? I mean, this is what he meant when he said, "I know the thoughts that I have toward you, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." And who would have known that God would have done it through a series of dreams and through a fiery furnace? But God is not without means to do whatever it is that he wants to do. When God makes a promise, his ability to keep the promise is beyond our ability to understand. So Nebuchadnezzar's fury, his anger, then is used to establish this captive. These captives in the city of Babylon. I would guess that they had pretty good standing at that point in the nation of Babylon. Here he said, anybody who messes with these people, who says a thing about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's God, I'll tear them limb for limb. This guy has got a lot of threats going, by the way. But, you know, these were real things. I mean, he was king. He could do it. It sounds like the king of England, you know, or the queen of England, excuse me. She's got a fine collection of cars and a lot of houses, and I think she got a lot of horses or something, but she doesn't have a lot of power. This guy had absolute, straight-up power. So, finally, the last portion. God uses now a dream to redeem Nebuchadnezzar. Now, you may disagree with me on this. I understand. That's okay. But I think at the end of this whole narrative in chapter 4, turn to chapter 4, if you will, that Nebuchadnezzar gets saved. And he gets saved in a time of judgment. God proclaims judgment against Nebuchadnezzar, and through this judgment, mercy comes. Isn't that the way it is with God? Why are you here today? If you know Christ as your Savior, if you have trusted in Christ, in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, and you are trusting in him, if that is your hope, you are here because of judgment. Because Christ was judged in your place as your substitutionary sacrifice. He took the stripes that I deserved. He took the punishment and the fire and the wrath that I deserved. And so we are here by virtue of judgment. And I want to just make one more statement before we hit the fourth verse or the fourth chapter here. And that is this, that when we ask, how do people in the Old Testament get saved? How do they get saved? They get saved by the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. Is that right? And while the gospel itself in the Old Testament appears in shadow form, it doesn't come to its full light. It is just as efficacious in Genesis chapter 3 as it is in John chapter 3. It's just as powerful in Adam and Eve's life as it was in James and John and Peter and Andrew's life. Just as powerful, just as eternally saving in those two instances. But in the Old Testament, of course, it's in shadow form. We don't see the fullness of the picture, even though the fullness of the work is readily available to everyone who will repent of their sins and believe that God is who he says he is. Now, let me give you an example. Gospel in the Old Testament, what's the first commandment? I am the Lord God who brought you out of the house of, out of the land of Egypt and out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other God before me. Is that correct? And what did Jesus say? We're going to have this next week. I'm going to steal a little bit of thunder from Josh. But what did Jesus say? He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes unto the Father but by me. Do you see how those two verses are parallel? How they work together to serve one message? I mean, here we have the gospel in the law. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other God beside me. That is John 14, 6, isn't it? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. That's the narrow way. That's the exclusive way. That's the only way to God. Nebuchadnezzar's building of an image, Nebuchadnezzar's agreeing with Daniel, even though his mind is completely somewhere else. Friendliness to the gospel, church membership, baptism, all of those things have a certain value in a believer's life, but they have absolutely no value for the unbeliever because they cannot help you. They cannot assist you. In fact, all of the works in the world, all of the baptisms in the world could actually blind you to the fact that you have one thing and one thing alone that you need, and that is that you need the forgiveness of sins. Without the forgiveness of sins, no man shall see God. Remember that, again, the gospel in the Old Testament is a shadow. The gospel in the New Testament is the same gospel, but it's revealed to us in its fullest flower. Now, I'm not saying that's all, because when we get to heaven, we're going to see the gospel in a way we've never seen it before. But you know, Peter, the gospel according to Peter, is he says there's no other name given among men under heaven whereby we must be saved. Isn't that Exodus 20, verse 1 and 2? Isn't it the same exact message? And so, here we have Nebuchadnezzar. We're going to begin with the first verse, and we're going to skip right to the end. Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 4, verses 1. Now, Nebuchadnezzar, he's going to give his testimony here, and then he's going to explain how he got where he was and how God showed mercy on him in his life. Notice, verse 1 of Daniel chapter 4, King Nebuchadnezzar, to all the peoples, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth, peace be multiplied to you. Now, this is many, many, many years later after the first dream. It's near the end of his reign. And I think he reigned 46 years, so... But anyway, he says, peace be multiplied to you. It has seemed good to me to show the signs and wonders that the Most High God has done for me. How great are his signs, how mighty are his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion endures from generation to generation. You see that what follows this shows that Daniel, or that Nebuchadnezzar learned the lesson, didn't he, in Daniel chapter 2. He learned the lesson that the rock cut out without hands that crushes all of these empires has grown up and will consume the whole world and will fill the whole world. The kingdom of God in Christ will fill the whole world. And he's learned that lesson. And then he explains how it happens, and we know the story. He has another dream. God uses another dream to talk to this man. And the dream is of this giant tree that all the birds of the air rested in and all the beasts of the field got their shade from. And along comes somebody and chops the tree down. And then Daniel says, "You're the tree." And remember, Nebuchadnezzar, remember what happened to him? He was driven out from the palace and he was cast out into the fields, and he became a crazy man. He was a lunatic. His hair grew long. I always knew the hippies were lunatics. You know that? I mean, I always knew there was something wrong with them. I'd never have long hair. Yeah, I did at one time. But anyway, I can't now. I can't now, and so therefore, since I can't now, I'm completely against it. But here's the point. He had long hair, so we don't know how long he was out there. It says he was out there 7 times, and I think the Lord put that in there that way just so that lunatics could speculate over that. You know, was it 7 months or was it 7 years? And then you could have all these intramural biblical debates. But he was out there for quite a while, and his fingernails grew long, and he drooled, no doubt, and he ate grass like an oxen, and the dew of heaven rested on. So he didn't even know enough to crawl in a hole someplace at night. I mean, he just laid out in the open. And then finally, he looks up to heaven, and his eyes are open, and he understands all of the things he never understood before. And this is what he understood. And we have it with our opening verse. Remember, we opened, our big idea was Daniel 4:34 and 35. He understands this. He says, and this is chapter 34. Chapter 4, verse 34, "At the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up my eyes to heaven, and my reason returned to me, and I blessed the Most High and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation." Remember, that's the story of the rock, isn't it? A dominion that's an everlasting dominion that lasts from generation to generation. "All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing. And he does according to his will among the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. And none can stay his hand or say to him, 'What have you done? What have you done, Lord? Why did you send us into captivity? Have you abandoned me completely? Won't you help me?'" This morning, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, if you're Nebuchadnezzar, you know, you got part of the message. You've been gospel friendly. You've come to church. I would implore you. I know, I want a little evangelical moment here if we can, but I know that as God's who regenerates, and that without regeneration, we cannot repent or believe the gospel. I understand that. But we can cry out to God, "God, will you help me? God, will you show me your face? God, will you favor me with your gospel? Will you show me what it is to believe and be saved? Will you give me a heart of repentance?" Without the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, there is no hope. There was no hope for Nebuchadnezzar until God touched his heart, changed his mind, and gave him repentance and faith. Well, may the Lord bless his word to our heart.